I figured since I was in seeing tonight's show, you know, that I'd get dressed up. So, I don't know if I ever did it. Actually, there's a story behind Tuxedo I'd like to tell you tonight. About 8 or 9 years ago, back in Worcester, Massachusetts, on a Saturday afternoon, my then wife and I decided that instead of staying in the house and arguing like we usually did on Saturday, that we'd go for a nice drive, you know, and argue in the car. And we came upon one of these antique furniture, old used clothing, knick-knack, old book boutiques, right? You've seen these places. You go in there, and there's stuff everywhere. Right? What? Everywhere. Stuff everywhere. You know, there's stuff hanging up, and stuff in boxes, and on shelves, and all of that, you know? And we walked in, and there was a picture, a dusty picture of Herbert Hoover in the corner, and cigar boxes full of authentic bronze, American Indian jewelry, and vases of every size and description, filigree, and there was a diary of a Norwegian shepherd in there. And the owner comes out through one of these beaded entryways, a flower child from the 60s, you know. And evidently, she was not able to decide what jewelry to put on that morning because it looked like she put everything on that she owned. She came out clinging and clanging and emitting about 3 or 4 different body oil scents. I detected musk and patchouli and a few others. So anyway, my wife immediately engages her in conversation about a Chinese homunculus, circa 400 BC. Anyway, I figured this was my chance to break away and investigate the inner recesses of this place and maybe turn up something exotic, you know, like some back issues of Mad Magazine or something. And after rummaging through some old songbooks of Rosemary Clooney, I spotted this tuxedo just hanging there next to a 1959 box of Tide. And I checked it out. No large moth holes. All the buttons were on. And I figured I could get the body oil, smell out of it. And so I went over, I tried it on, and it was a little big, it still is. But I figured I could have it tailored, which I haven't. And it was only $40. So I thought, this is great, I've got to have this. So I took it off the rack and brought it over to the desk. And my wife was just hanging up the phone from ordering a large U-Haul for her purchases. And she says to me, where are you going to wear a tuxedo? And I shot back immediately. How about the divorce proceedings? We weren't getting along very well, you know. But she had a point, you know. Where was I going to wear a tuxedo? And I got to tell you something about myself. I'm not a swinger. You know? I'm not a socialite. I don't get invited to big events or anything like that. So, you know, she had a point. Where was I going to wear a tuxedo? But a tuxedo with tails and everything, $40, it just seemed to be right. So I bought it, obviously. And so we left the place, and she got into her car, and drove away, and I got into the U-Haul, drove that over. Now, to continue the story, I have to take you back in time a little bit. One of my wedding gifts to my wife was an old, beautiful, superbly maintained, upright piano. I put a big red ribbon around it, and she loved it, but after 3 years of marriage, she never played it. So I decided that, even though at the age of 35, that I was going to take piano lessons. I had this beautiful piano, so why not? So I found myself a good teacher. She happened to be the wife of a colleague of mine at the college where I taught. And her approach was traditional, you know, scales, arpeggios, Clemente, Anna Magdalena's notebook, some easy Bartok. And unlike, you know, some of the nouveau progressive types that start you out with riffs of Aaron Copland, And so only after 3 months of lessons, she lays a bombshell on me. I am required to play in a recital. Twice a year, she hosted in her home a recital in which all of her students were required to play. Now I had a place to wear my tuxedo. So I practiced this little 2 or 3 minute piece, you know, like crazy for 2 weeks. And the big day finally came. So I got a manicure, trimmed my beard, shined my head. I put on my tuxedo, I looked great. And I gotta tell you something about my teacher's students, except for me. All of her students were between the ages of 5 and 16, and most of them were younger than 12. And she had this recital in her large living room with a piano up front, and then there was a row of chairs for the students, and then there were 6 or 7 rows of chairs for the parents, and in my case, my wife. And I didn't realize till I got to the recital that the order on the program, and therefore the seating arrangement, the seating thing, was according to skill level. That is, the newer, presumably less skillful students would be first, with the teenage virtuosos rounding out the program playing last. So, you know, the seating arrangement was according to the order in the program. I was in the third chair. A 5-year-old was first, a 6-year-old was second, then me, then another 6-year-old, then the 7-year-old. Now, you've got to appreciate this from the parent's perspective in the back. You've got a little 5-year-old, then you've got a 6-year-old, then you've got this 35-year-old bald guy in a tuxedo, then you've got another 6-year-old, then you've got another 7-year-old, and so on. Now, I was about to start. Teacher came up and made some opening remarks, and then she introduced the first student, who was Jessica Forrest, I remember. Jessica Forrest, she had on this little pink dress and little flowers around the collar, and the dress sort of billowed a little bit. She had on these white socks, turned over, you know, once, and these black tap dancing-like shoes with a little ankle strap on. And she bounded from the chair, literally climbed up onto the piano bench. She sat there for a few seconds, and she started to giggle. And the other kids started to giggle. And then I started to giggle. Hang in. So anyway, she broke into this moving rendition of Three Blind Mice or something. And everybody was applauding enthusiastically. Next on the program was Jonas Berkowitz, 6 years old. Jonas was dressed in a brown three-piece corduroy suit. He had a white cotton shirt with a flared collar, gold cufflinks, floor shines, and horn-rimmed glasses. His parents brought with them a music critic from the New York Times and a photographer, cameras clicking and lights flashing. So Jonas rose from the chair, approached the bench. Jonas had all the demeanor of Leonard Bernstein at Tanglewood. Anyway, he finished his piece, and his parents were applauding wildly. I was next. And I could feel this wave of curious anticipation sort of wafting over me from the parents' seats. And for the past 2 weeks, I had visualized hundreds of times flipping my tails. So I got up. I neared the bench. I looked back at the kids. Deftly flipped my tails. And I sat down. And the kids started to giggle. And I started to giggle. And the parents and my wife started to giggle. And I played. Not flawlessly, but I played. The parents loved me, gave me a standing ovation. Anyway, that's my tuxedo story. So, let's get on.
Peter Flaherty.
Come on, you guys. We got more than one. You know what I mean? Get up. Well, it's good, but we used to do this.
Our paychecks weren't back there, so.
Your paycheck?
From last week, we didn't.
Last call about that. I don't know how to do that. So here they are. Give them a big hand. As we usually do with our Frisian switch. So let's have a couple of players out here. Alan never comes out first. Okay, Gary. Okay, so let's give them a relationship.
What?
Brothers.
Brothers, okay. Seems to be a consensus. How about, let's put them someplace.
Football game.
At a football game. Brothers at a football game.
Football game at college.
What are they doing? Are they playing or watching? Selling peanuts?
Are they in the band?
So they're brothers at a football game and selling
in the band?
Brothers at a football game and you're selling peanuts. Hit it.
Deaf brothers at a peanuts! Some bird just ate all of our peanuts. You hear him? God. Hey, peanuts!
Get your peanuts!
Hey! I made 50 grand doing this last year. Do you believe it? This is great!
I believe it.
Peanuts, come on, a fucking bag. Don't mind them, they're just trying to horn in. Come on, peanuts, come on,
dogs here! Dogs here!
How'd you go hot dogs?
Beer!
How'd you get
dogs! Mustard, huh?
Okay!
You should be out there in the field. Did you ever think of that?
Oh, I'm a real hot dogger. Yeah, okay.
Oh, quarterback potential. Let's see that. Come on, hit that guy down
free.
There.
Free! you didn't hear me. That was yesterday that I apologized. Well, if you want to know the truth, I heard you yesterday.
You heard me yesterday?
Yeah, but I didn't believe you.
But the day before when I apologized, you did believe me.
Well, when you apologized yesterday, you had this look like, I shouldn't believe you.
So you mean last week when I had that look where you usually do believe me, but I wasn't apologizing?
Well, you see, it had something to do with the way...
Do it again if you don't hit me.
You're making this very hard on me, Lolly. You said that, and I didn't hit you, and then you said it again.
Why is that hand up there then?
Freeze! Anything but the pie, Mr. Buffo!
Thank you. see how we could be brothers and sisters, but but as Siamese, it seems a little.
Oh, what a wonderful
idea!
I was speaking with one of the doctors. It was like this really unusual genetic split. And it has to do with the receptive gene that goes back about.
Read.
There's something else that we can do. We can mend that
Can we see behind the door?
Oh, take this beautiful art object there. And you know, I really think that you're almost there.
You know, when I was in kindergarten, I did one like that. Everyone thought it was a little too fast.
Well, you know, when you're older in that school, you're allowed to break every rule.
Oh, good. I like that a lot. Let's make another pot.
Okay,
Firefighter.
Okay, we've been fired before, so that's okay. Where?
China! China!
Wait a minute, you got both of them.
No!
What?
No!
What?
No.
Firefighters in the dome. Firefighters in the dome?
Yeah.
And I was going to say, what are they doing? What are they doing? Working on a truck in the dome?
Firefighters.
Say that again.
Okay, you're firefighters in the dome, and you're working on a truck. That's what they want.
They're on our trucks in the dome,
though. No. We'll use what we can.
No, you're firefighters outside the dome.
Outside the dome.
Outside.
There's something wrong with this wheel. I think I'm gonna paint it teal.
While you're doing that, I'll go polish my hat.
Okay, it looks quite good now. It's the snow though, man.
Nightshade family? That's why it's celebrated on the new moon for the St. Patrick's Day. Its Latin name is Solanum tuberus sosum. And it was originally native to, and you wouldn't believe it, any guesses where it's originally
Peru.
Native to?
Peru!
Yeah, who said that? Yeah, Peru, how'd you know that?
I read a lot. new experts. Bring them up. Okay, here we go. Now, since it is International Potato Day, well, we have here two experts, and they're quite knowledgeable just about anything. So, since it is International Potato Day, you got a topic.
Subject is potato peeling. So, Professor Hard, you have something to say on that subject.
It's a very, very appealing topic. And I don't have to shred it. Why he's half baked tonight. I don't know. You know, there's so many topics. There's world peace. There's, you know, ending world hunger. There's badge check. There are all kinds of critical topics in the world. And it just seems like a total waste of everybody's time.
Hunger. What about the Irish potato famine? Do you have
anything to say? Now that is a topic I would absolutely love to talk about. Absolutely love to talk about.
Well, it's too bad, Mr. Harvey. We just don't have enough time now.
Story of my
yes,
life.
Yes, very good. Thank you very much.
Again.
I got something. Looks like fish.
They plant fish?
It's frozen hard, solid. Let's try dynamite. Look, a mackerel. That's a potato mackerel.
Not too fresh.
Must be a way.
This won't work.
We need shovels. Or pitchforks.
That's an idea.
But the ice.
You picked Alaska.
Yeah. Cheap plane tickets.
That's some excuse.
Let's eat walrus.
Good idea, Charlie.
two-parter.
No.
Okay. Two words.
You first.
See?
Gimme!
No.
Now!
Go! Wait!
Race. Now? Time.
No.
Seven.
No. Eight.
Look! Wow! Starving! Go! 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 Oh!
Lost. Money.
Gone.
None.
Life.
Friends.
I'm a big fan of brevity. Okay, a little bit of potato tidbit here. Did you know that one medium-sized potato, boiled and unpeeled, provides 120 calories, low in fat, high in vitamin C, and according to some nutritionists, the consumption of 5 pounds of potatoes per day and 1 quart of milk will provide all the nutrients essential to the human diet. After I went through the Encyclopedia Britannica, I called the clinic and let them know about that. And the seed balls of the potato are poisonous, although I think the Capital Kitchen keeps them in. Okay, now, for our next improvisational piece, it's called Emo. Nick? Betsy. Emo, short for
British
emotion.
Emo.
What?
British Emo.
British Emo.
British.
Here we go. Okay, let's give them a relationship.
Okay. Anything you like.
Aliens.
Britons, right? Britons.
Aliens.
Aliens. Aliens?
Yeah.
Okay, they're fellow aliens. Okay. Does that mean they're from another planet, or are they just English?
Put them in Ireland.
Okay, they're English. Where are they?
In Ireland.
In Ireland. What are they doing? Mama's class. They're English, yeah. emotions. Okay?
Fear.
Excitement. Okay, we'll
go. Fear, English.
Happy. Oh, that's right, for English. Excitement, surprise, they're pretty close.
Something else?
Boredom.
Boredom.
Passion.
Boredom.
Nervous.
Condescension.
Oh,
I like that.
Afraid.
English, you know the condescension.
Afraid.
Confusion? How's that? How about one more?
Vampirism.
Afraid.
Embarrassed.
Fear. Okay, guys, so you start the scene here, and then we'll hit them with some emotions.
Okay, Harold, so what do I do first?
Well, I don't know. I'll tell you the truth. I'm waiting for the instruction. I read the book first, but it was terribly odd. It was all confusing. You had to breathe in time or something. I mean, you know how to breathe. Why do you have to train you how to breathe?
Nervous.
I don't think you're even going to be able to do it. You don't breathe at the best of times. I know what you're doing. Don't mention telling baby. How? I can't imagine. How does it happen? Actually, you're right.
The great Aunt Martha had heard. You remember what happened?
Boredom.
I remember what happened. God, I was there 10 hours.
That terrible waiting room.
No, it's worse than this class. There's something that's stuck. God. You're going to come here every week for 10 weeks. And you're going to learn how to read. Book next time. I mean, three books.
Let's do something. Sit down.
Oh, God, I don't want
to. Excitement.
Oh, sitting. That's great, great, great.
Exciting part of the show, and the potato tidbit. The name of the potato grown in Idaho is the russet Burbank potato. You know that?
Wow.
All right. Its tubers are slightly flattened with heavily netted skin and numerous well-distributed eyes. punch of karma. Anyway, we got a great thing for you here. We have the great Punod.
Oh.
We have the whole troop against our pun man, Alan Hart. All right, now here's the thing, okay? We're going to pick a little topic. We're going to pick a topic. And as the player here has a pun, they step forward, do their pun, step back.
Alan's first.
Okay? Alan's first, okay?
Wait.
Huh?
Hunby.
Can I just say a little something?
Yeah.
No.
The reason we're doing it this way is because we tried to have a pun off with Alan, just one of us, and none of us. I mean, so we said, look, all of us, okay? And we're scared.
Now, but if nobody steps forward, okay, we start the countdown. 5, 4, 3, and if at the end of one, nobody comes in, Al's one, you know. So since,
right,
don't forget to breathe. Since this is International Potato Day, we could get maybe some topic related to that, potato growing. You want to get off potatoes, you know, let's get off potatoes. I've had enough potatoes myself.
Tailoring.
He's a masher anyway.
Okay, tailoring, let's get into the whole clothes area of clothes. Let's try that. Okay, that's pretty broad. Go.
Okay, well, they kind of have me in stitches being here.
I've invested so much time in this, Alan.
Well, you sort of should address the conversation, that's all.
Or so it seems.
So what?
I don't know if this is going to suit Alan, this topic.
They're all just needling me.
It's because you're such a stitch.
She's just skirting the issue. Strung me up to dry, and I just feel like this is a local hangout.
Suck it to us, Alan.
Shoo, will you?
I can see you're tailoring your remarks for this crowd.
Well, you want this shirt off my back?
This may deserve a bit of a belt.
Okay, well, I'll just have to buckle up. Was like that used to buckle?
It's all right.
Okay, I will. But, you know, getting back to the shoe thing and everything, my like soul brothers here are just all a bunch of deals.
Alan, I'm supposed to be tied when you talk like that.
I'm tongue-tied.
Too many ties.
You think she's gonna pocket the prize?
Well, I mean, tie goes to the runner. Any joggers out here?
I hear you had a date with Elizabeth.
What's that?
I hear you had a date with Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, not. Oh, I see. Okay. Next topic, you know, I mean, you know, okay, so.
It's unraveling.
What's that?
The whole thing is unraveling.
Well, you know, you're like all too seemly for me and everything, and I think that, you know, I'm feeling more and more pressed, and I think that like we all can iron these things out, and the thing is, I'm just trying to let off some steam.
Like I got some good potato trivia in the second half. trivia, different from tidbits, potato trivia. Okay, we're going to do gather some information now for a scene we're going to do that's going to kick off the second half. It's called Three Sentences. Now, you may have seen us do this individually, where we get three sentences from you, and then we give you a story. And that story begins with the first sentence, ends with the last, and somewhere in between, we use the second sentence. But what we're going to do is we're going to enact a scene, start off the second half, that's going to include those three sentences. So what we'd like to get from you are the three sentences.
Unrelated.
Politics.
Unrelated.
Crown the king's head.
Unrelated.
Excuse me, again?
Crown the king's head.
I wonder if that crown affected him.
My tie is too tight.
Crown the king's head. My tie is too tight.
I'm going to be late for program.
Never spoke to her again.
What?
And he never spoke to her.
No, it'd be late for program.
The ducks? Made it difficult for actually kiss them on the mouth. This one
went on for hours and hours. Finally, they let her off, and the ducks went to their own country. And you know, the ducks never spoke to her again.
Piece is called The Movers. So we have Paul, Stan, Marcy, Betsy. Okay, now we'd like a relationship for these people.
Coneheads.
What?
Coneheads.
Coneheads.
That's a family.
Yeah. Yeah. I've heard of that. Okay, we'll play with that. They're from
France.
It's okay. France. And they drink a lot of beer. So they're gonna drink beer. I'm not gonna drink beer.
Doing?
What are they doing?
Wine.
They're at a restaurant. You're at a restaurant eating at a restaurant, okay? Wait a minute, what do we gotta decide on something here? You got restaurants okay? Yeah. TSR registration, we like that, okay. But we don't like that. Say yes. All right, we're in a restaurant. They're coneheads in a restaurant in France.
Honey, we're home.
Beldar, this stuff stinks.
I get the point. Like me now.
It was your comb tasted of other women.
It must have been something I ate.
All this French cooking, I suppose.
Let me use my knee then.
Inside story. And again, you'll see why we call it inside story. So, Lolly, Mo, Gary, and Paul. Confusion here, we're gonna straighten out here.
Okay.
Do you
want chairs?
I don't like chairs.
You don't have
a chair. Controversy about chairs up here. This is all part of the skit.
I do enjoy that.
Okay, thanks a lot. That's okay, relationship for these two people.
Children on the playground.
Children on the playground.
You've seen this before.
Oh, yeah, I like that. Children on the playground. Yeah, okay. Where on the playground?
Swing set.
Do you want something more specific? No.
That's
children on the playground. Take it.
Jungle gym?
Hi, Susie.
Yeah.
God, I hope I don't like girls.
Yuck, it's you again.
Oh, he's cute.
Want some sand, honey?
Maybe should we don't have to eat it.
I don't want to play with you.
I want to marry you.
Well, why don't we just swing on the swing or something?
I knew I should have brought my G.I. Joe.
Well, oh good if you'll push me.
I wonder if you'll notice the hole in my tights.
Okay, here I go.
Oh my God, her pants are split.
Are you looking?
Oh, this could be really embarrassing.
I'm looking, but not at you.
I really know your name. I just love to hear you say it.
Stumpy.
I hate my parents for naming me that.
Probably don't know this, but when Maharishi said that the knowledge is structured in consciousness. What happened was that the tape ended right there and actually went on to say, and potatoes. And we remember at the end of Gone with the Wind, when Rhett Butler said to Scarlett O'Hara, frankly, Scarlett, I don't give a damn. And what he was actually talking about, she asked him, what do you want for lunch, potatoes? And that's what he said. And the next one is, why is the Mona Lisa smiling? She just had potatoes. No, I know. So this is trivia. Okay, we'll move on to the next scene. Okay, this scene is called Silent Tension. Now in this scene, the players are going to communicate through their silence who they are, where they are, and what their situation is.
Tater tots factory.
Yeah,
a tour of the tater tots factory.
Mommy!
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 Mommy! it's such a great visit to this factory.
Best time on our honeymoon, I think.
Hey, whatever you want. It was a great honeymoon.
Okay, shall we?
Sure.
Great. First slide. This is what the potatoes look like before they're peeled.
They were huge.
They were great.
Next slide.
Was when something fell into the frying oil right
there. Oh, yeah! Somebody lost their wig!
That's right!
Yeah! Yeah,
he was trying to reach for it, but I guess it just ended up in a package somewhere. Yeah. But it was labeled probably.
Yeah, it was the right color. It was okay.
Next slide, please. Was this all our honeymoon?
That's when the potato crawled out of the vat. I remember it now.
Crawled out of the vat, dear.
I never knew. What was it?
I think it was one of the workmen.
Yes.
Click. Next slide.
Oh, I remember this.
Oh, yes. This. I remember this one.
Each of you at your home.